You may be seated, friends. It's good to see you this morning. Now, I don't know about you, but when I was growing up, I was really good at like keeping time in a church service. I could tell like by, you know, when certain things happened, if we were on time or not. So if you're like me and that's your specialty, then today is not your day. Sorry. We've kind of changed up our order a little bit today. We have, like Heather just told you, we've got our kids coming in. So I get to set up the kids who are going to finish the message. They're going to do an awesome job of that today. So you're in for a treat with them. Hey, we've been talking in this message series about how the cross of Jesus helps us to cross over from one area of struggle into another area of life. And today we're talking about how the cross of Jesus helps us to transition from a position of selfish to one of selfless. Because we as people, we kind of default to the selfish setting. That's just how it works for most all of us. But Jesus helps us to live a life that's much bigger than just our own selfishness. I was reminded this week of a story from my childhood. It was about 1990. I was about 10 years old. And I was hanging out with my friends from the neighborhood. That was Brian, Jared, and Jacob. We would go on all sorts of adventures together. Do you have friends like that? You'd go around, you do whatever it was that you like to do. So we lived out in the country a little bit. So there was a creek near our house. And that was one of our favorite things to do, was go hiking around that creek and see what we could discover. So we were going kind of in a new direction that day and a little farther out than usual. And this creek was in a little bit of a ravine. So there was a steep hillside that went up about 30 feet high beside the creek. And in central Illinois, that's what we call a mountain, right? That's big time tall for central Illinois. So we were walking along by the creek, and Jared looked up and he saw something that we had never discovered before. He saw this tree that was growing kind of sideways out of the hillside near the top of the ravine. And attached to this tree was the biggest rope swing we had ever seen. And we were so excited. We climbed up the side of that ravine because you could pull that thing way up so that the top of the rope would be near the top of that tree in terms of height and swing out. And we were getting ready to give it a try. We should have probably been a little concerned, right? I mean, this could go wrong in any number of ways, but YouTube hadn't been invented yet to warn us of all the potential problems, like these, for example.
Wipe out!
Don't try this at home, right? There's lots of ways this could go wrong. But so we're there, and we're climbing up the ravine with the rope, and we're debating amongst ourselves who should go first. And these debates were usually ended about the same way, because Brian was the one among us who had the highest level of self-confidence combined with the lowest level of IQ. So you can guess who wanted to go first, right? Brian had no fear of anything. And so as Brian is pulling the rope up and he's just getting ready to launch out over the ravine, Jared stops him with an all-important question. Jared said, "Brian, if you swing out over this ravine and the rope breaks and you die, can I have your Nintendo? Because that is what we lived for." Let me tell you, that was a big deal, right? These 8-bit Nintendos, that was our center of our life. And so while we should have been concerned for Brian's safety, we were more concerned about his estate planning, right? Making sure that he had all his important preparations set. The idea of Brian crashing into the ravine seemed to us more of a good business opportunity than a significant risk that we should be worried about. We were a little more worried about ourselves than Brian. We were a lot more worried about ourselves. And that's kind of a human default. We tend to think of ourselves first. It's not that we're trying to be mean or rude or whatever. It's just we have this kind of selfish bent about us. It's part of our sinful nature. We're going to look at a story from today from Jesus' life where Jesus has just done something odd. He's predicted his own death. That's not something that we all do, hopefully, but Jesus did it three different times in the book of Mark. This is the third time that he's done it, and in each of those times, the disciples react in kind of a strange way. It's like they sort of understand it, but they really are kind of in denial about what it really means. So Mark 10:35, then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came over and spoke to him. "Teacher," they said, "we want you to do us a favor." "What is it?" he asked. "In your glorious kingdom, we want to sit in places of honor next to you," they said, "one at your right and the other at your left." So basically, Jesus has said, "I'm going to die," and their response is, "Okay, then who of us gets to be number one and number two," right? Who gets to, you know, there's 12 disciples here. How are we going to have the pecking order of importance? They immediately go to the selfishness. How can we put ourselves personally in the best position? So, some scholars think that James and John were actually biological cousins of Jesus. So this could have been seen as nepotism, right? They're asking Jesus, you know, hey, let's kind of keep it in the family here, right? There's a lot of different reasons why they might have asked this. Jesus had nicknamed James and John, who were brothers, he had nicknamed them the Sons of Thunder because they were known for being a little trigger happy. Like one time they were out with Jesus and they were traveling and they got to a town. They were going to stay the night there. Well, the local people didn't want them to stay the night. They weren't willing to open up a place for them to stay. And so James and John were mad about this and they said, "Lord, do you want us to call down fire from heaven and destroy them?" Which is a little over the top, don't you think? I mean, it just seems a little unbalanced, not to mention Jesus never did this kind of thing, right? He may have had all power in heaven and on earth, but he tended to use that to, like, feed people and heal people, not so much to, like, make s'mores out of the locals, right? That wasn't really his thing. And so Jesus, James and John, they're a little quick on the trigger, and here they're jumping in and they're wanting to take over. They're wanting kind of the prison rules approach to succession planning for Jesus' power in his kingdom. So what does Jesus do here? He answers them and he says, "You don't know what you're asking," verse 38. "Are you able to drink from the bitter cup of sorrow that I'm about to drink? Are you able to be baptized with the baptism of suffering I must be baptized with?" I mean, this is serious stuff, right? Jesus, we know what happens. He goes to the cross. He dies. He had just predicted this to them. And what do they say? "Yes, we're able to do that. Sure, we don't know what you're talking about, but we'll do it. We want to be number one and number two, so whatever it takes." Jesus is making a very morbid reference here. This cup of sorrow refers to one of the forms of capital punishment the Romans used was to make the person drink an entire cup of poison. They would die that way. And so it was commonly practiced in Rome. In fact, it had been practiced for years before that in Greece because we know Socrates himself was killed this way and he denied many of the Greek gods. They made him drink poison. So Jesus is basically referring to this. He's saying, "Are you really willing to die like I'm going to die?" And they say, "Sure, we can do that." Jesus answers in verse 39, "You'll indeed drink from my cup and be baptized with my baptism, but I have no right to say who will sit on the thrones next to mine. God has prepared those places for the ones he has chosen." When the 10 other disciples discovered what James and John had asked, they were indignant. That's no shock, is it? I mean, here we have 12 guys, and they find out that two of them have tried to do an end run around the system and tried to put themselves in the best possible position. This is not going to go over well, is it? I'm sure James and John were kind of trying to be subtle with this request, but the others find out and they're mad. So now you got 12 guys and they're sitting around trying to fight over who's going to be most important. Who's the biggest dog in the bunch? It's a common human fight that we have. We oftentimes want to see ourselves as better than others. Maybe we have more tact. Maybe we have better strategy. But oftentimes we basically live our lives this way. How can we make sure that we take care of us and the rest of the world, they'll figure it out. We're really just predominantly concerned with ourselves, whether it's financially or just with helping others and serving others, whether it's with our time, whatever it may be, we tend to get a little bit self-centered. And so the disciples are angry. They're having this conflict among one another. It's a good reminder to us that as you're dealing with selfishness, as you're dealing with the selfishness of yourself or of others in your life, it's going to lead to conflict. In fact, if you know other people, that will lead to conflict, right? Because people, that's kind of what we do. We tend to disagree. If you're, say, in a family or have friends or have a job that involves other people or come to church, I can guarantee you will experience conflict in life. It is part of it. And conflict in and of itself is not a bad thing. It's a normal part of the human experience. The challenge is, what do we do with that conflict? How do we manage it? How do we handle it in our own lives? Like Heather said earlier, Easter's coming very soon. It's a great chance to invite your friends to Easter. And on Easter, one of the things we'll be talking about is this new series that we're going to be starting the week after Easter. We're doing a church-wide study, which is where we sync up our messages on Sunday morning and our community groups. And we launched some new community groups as well. And the study we're going to be doing is called Resolving Everyday Conflict, because this is one of the key issues that we got to work on in our lives if we are going to have Jesus, if we're going to become more and more like Jesus, if we're going to grow in our faith. We've got a quick video clip about this. Let's check it out.
I want to take it easy. Work's been hard this year. I want to go to the beach. What's the problem?
Yeah, but we went to the beach last year because of the same reason.
Yeah, and we got to relax. We got to take it easy. That's what I'm talking about.
That's not what I meant. And you know that. Yes, the beach was fun. We all had a great time, but my father is not going to be around forever, and I don't want to feel like I missed this opportunity to spend time with him. I don't know why we always have to go through this. I wish you could just...
How many of us have a kitchen that looks a bit like that, at least some of the time? Simple discussion about where we're going on vacation is suddenly this full-blown argument between two people who love each other. Conflict shows up everywhere in our lives. Maybe it's not the big blow-up, but just those everyday difficult situations in our kitchens, you know, with our kids, in our dorm rooms, in our neighborhoods, and at the places we work. You know, a lot of people remodel how their kitchen looks, and that's fine. But you would be amazed at what can happen when God remodels what's going on inside your kitchen.
That scene in the kitchen, familiar to anybody? I figured probably not here, right? We don't have conflict at Stillwater, right? But for all those other people you know that have this, it could be relevant. And I'm guessing it's relevant to our lives as well. How we deal with conflict is one of the key parts in our spiritual growth, to become more and more like Jesus. So I hope you'll join us for that. So the disciples, they're struggling with this conflict. They're struggling with one another. And Jesus intervenes. Verse 42. Jesus called them together and said, "You know that in this world, kings are tyrants, and officials lord it over the people beneath them. But among you, it should be quite different. Whoever wants to be a leader among you must be your servant. Whoever wants to be first must be the slave of all. For even I, the Son of Man, came here not to be served, but to serve others, and to give my life as a ransom for many." These are Jesus' words. And you have to understand how countercultural these words were. These were very contrary to the prevailing logic in Jesus' day. See, in the Roman Empire, there were more slaves than servants than there were free people. If you're a free person, the last thing you wanted to do was to be serving others. True life was seen as having others serve you. Plato once said, "How can a person be happy when he has to serve someone else?" It's like it's impossible, right? If you have to serve somebody else, you just can't be happy. That's a miserable life. You want to have servants, not to be a servant. And Jesus takes it and he turns the whole thing on its head and says, "No, if you want to be first in my kingdom, you serve. That's what you do. You don't argue about who's number one. You don't vie for position with one another. You don't try to step on the other person so that you can be on top. No, if you want to serve," in your notes you'll see, you go to the back of the line. If you want to be first in God's kingdom, begin by going to the back of the line. That's strange advice, isn't it? That's exactly what Jesus says that we should do. Why? It's because of how Jesus himself lived his life. You see, Jesus came, he's the ultimate example of our faith, and Jesus himself lived a life of serving, ultimately by giving his life so that we can live. Jesus, the Son of God, comes down from heaven to this earth, and he makes this incredible choice, a choice to give his life, to pay the price for my sins and for your sins. That's some incredible love. That's some incredible grace that God shows us. And that's how much your life is worth, that the Son of God would give his life for you. Just a moment, our kids are going to come in and they're going to sing for us and they're going to lead us in this program where it really focuses all about Jesus. And it helps us understand Jesus' death, his resurrection, and what a joy that is. Because when you understand the power of Jesus' resurrection, when you understand what this is all about, you want to serve others. Because Jesus is our leader, we want to live a life like he lived. We say that if Jesus is risen from the dead, then certainly I want to live the way that he lived. I want to put others first. And our calling isn't to go to the cross per se, but our calling is to give our lives to him. And part of the way that we do that is by serving others. Would you pray with me? God, we give you thanks for Jesus, this incredible gift that you gave, Lord Jesus, when you gave your life for us. Lord, we thank you that you call us to serve. And God, I pray that you would help us in these moments to understand your gift even more, that you'd help us to understand your love for us, your forgiveness of us, your grace that is greater than we could ever ask or imagine. Lord, I pray for anybody here today who may not have experienced that love and grace in their life. Let today be the day that they say, Jesus, would you come into my heart? Would you change me? Would you forgive me? Would you save me and make me more like you? Lord, we love you and pray this in Jesus' holy name. Amen.